Thank you very much for the invitation. Sorry, I won't talk much about Shakespeare. Actually, I will talk about Shakespeare, but I mean, I won't lie to you. I'm not an expert on Shakespeare. I mean, I'm from Argentina, so I don't know much. I think you all know more than Shakespeare about me, so I don't dare talking much about Shakespeare. But I can tell you a little bit about this guy, who was an Argentinian writer, an amazing Argentinian writer. Some people say maybe the best writer in the Spanish language, at least in the 20th century, who was Jorge Luis Borges. And actually, he was quite linked to Shakespeare. So let me start very broad. And I really like these meetings because these meetings do something that is lacking in science and in arts. And it's somehow making these bridges between science and art. And that somehow represents how important is this to me. I mean, I have been interacting with artists for quite some time now. And I have this guy that you see here, Mariano, spending 1 year in my lab. He's a painter. He's a very good painter from Argentina. And this somehow represents our interaction. I'm interested in neuroscience, so I'm interested in drawing these neurons and networks of neurons, and he's interested in arts, and he's painting these Pollock-like patterns. But we all have common interest, which in our specific case was visual perception. We're both interested in how do we see, me from the neuroscience perspective, him from the artist perspective. And talking to guys like this, I work on visual perception since many years. I have read many books. He knows much more, I wouldn't say much more, but he knows many things that I didn't know before or that we don't know in neuroscience. So it's really a pity that meetings like this don't happen that often, and it's really a pity that we don't get to interact with each other as much. And this comes, I mean, we're not making a big revolution. I mean, this comes already from the old days with Leonardo. Leonardo was an amazing character that he was somehow mastering both arts and science. So we all know the paintings of Leonardo, I mean, Gioconda and so on. And then we know some of his drawings. I mean, Leonardo actually, he studied anatomy very seriously. Actually, he studied anatomy because he wanted to improve his painting. He wanted to know exactly how the muscles run in the body so that he can paint them better, right? So he was somehow doing a bit of science to help his art. And we also know about other stuff from Leonardo, like this drawing showing ideas of a helicopter or a tank or a submarine and so on. So he was also developing technology. And a few times I wonder myself, why don't we have these interactions more often? And it happened to me interacting with artists and with scientists that I start to understand why, but it's a pity. So if I deal with my colleagues, for example, if I try to publish a paper of what I do in arts, I have a very hard time. It's not that easy. And the problem is because in science, we strive for objectivity. We want to have a formula that explains everything, right? And the more it explains, the better. In physics, I study physics. In physics, we're going from the single formula that explains the whole universe, right? Like the formula that contains all the forces in the universe. And art is completely the opposite from that. Even one thing, like looking at a painting, will have completely different reactions in different people. Art is the realm of subjectivity, which is exactly the opposite to what we look for in science. Well, we have to change science. I mean, we have to forget about objectivity and we have to go for other things, which are actually more interesting in many cases. So that's the problem of scientists. And the problem of artists, I mean, also somehow they are reluctant to talk to scientists in many cases. And what I found out is that in many cases, they have a wrong impression of a scientist. And sometimes we are guilty for this impression because they think we're coming with reductionist approaches and we come up to try to find out the equation of art. And this doesn't exist. And we will never do something as silly as that. We just want to understand better what makes us, I mean, emotion or feel or passion and things like that. Felipe? Okay, so over the years, I have interacted with many different people, I mean, from painters to magicians, who knows a lot about neuroscience, believe it or not. And I have a lot of interaction also with literature. And I couldn't interact with this person. I mean, he died, I mean, at the time I started to do science. But I interacted with his widow a lot, so he was telling me a lot about Borges. So let me tell you about Borges, and I will tell you two or three stories of Borges, the first one related to Shakespeare. So Borges was a writer in the 20th century. He became blind when he was 55, and he wrote amazing stories, and he always wrote short stories, right, and essays, but he never wrote a novel. So all his stories are 10, 20 pages long. And something that defines Borges, a couple of things, is that you read two lines and you just dig into the story. You cannot get out. I mean, he really drags you like this from the very first sentence. And the other thing is that he plays a lot with very clever ideas. And he has very, very clever ways of developing the story. So anytime you finish a Borges story, you stay thinking a lot because he makes you think. And so the first story I want to tell you about Borges is the one that is related to Shakespeare. It's called Shakespeare's Memory, La Memoria de Shakespeare in Spanish, right? He wrote this in 1983, shortly before he died. He died in 86. And that's a story of a scholar, a German scholar, that he's an expert on Shakespeare. He dedicates his whole life to study Shakespeare. And one day he's in a conference somewhere in London, and that's beginning of the 20th century, and he meets a colleague from England, and they go to a pub, they drink a few ales and so on, and then this colleague says, look, I offer you Shakespeare memory. And then this scholar from Germany, Hermann Sorgel or something like this, says, what do you mean with that? And then he says, do you want to have Shakespeare's memory? And the guy says, well, yes, of course. Well, do you formally want to have Shakespeare memory? Because if you say yes, I will transfer it to you, because I have them. And the guy says, yes, I agree. And this other professor say, well, you won't notice much of a difference now, but with time, this will come up. And don't force it. Don't try to sing your Shakespeare. Just let it flow. And then this guy wakes up. Nothing happened. He didn't feel anything. But as day passes by, he starts having funny feelings. It's like he starts having memories of faces or he's singing a tune that he never heard before. And he said, well, where did this come from? Actually, it comes from Shakespeare. So suddenly the memory, suddenly no, but with time, progressively, the memory of Shakespeare starts to get embedded into his brain. And that's a very interesting idea, and that will bring me to something that we discuss a lot. I'm not a philosopher, that philosopher has been discussing a lot. So let's see a couple of passages. So, one more. So let's see what Borges says about the story of this guy, Hermann Sorgel, right? What happens with this guy when he starts taking Shakespeare memories? So if you read Spanish, you understand Spanish, you have the original Spanish, the translation is on the bottom. So he said, throughout the first stage of this adventure, I felt the joy of being Shakespeare. Throughout the last, terror and oppression. At first, the water of the two memories did not mix. In time, the great torrent of Shakespeare threatened to flood my own modern stream, and very nearly did so. I noted with some nervousness that I was gradually forgetting the language of my parents. Since personal identity is based on memory, I fear for my sanity. Since personal identity is based on memory, that's written by a writer, no? That's a big statement. Since personal identity is based on memory. Huge philosophical discussion. Let's have one more passage. One more. So later on he says, this guy, Hermann Sorgel, the scholar from Germany that got Shakespeare memories, as the years pass, every man is forced to bear the growing burden of his memory. I stagger between the two, which sometimes mingled, my own and the incommunicable others. The wish of all things, Spinoza says, is to continue to be what they are. The stone wishes to be stone, the tiger, tiger, and I wanted to be Hermann Sorgel again. So it's a very fascinating story, but basically what Borges plays around is with the idea of memories defining who we are. We are our memories. That's a big statement, and I'm not saying that's true. I mean, actually, if you are here in Oxford, you may know of a philosopher called Derek Parfit who will challenge this with very, very strong arguments. And there are many philosophers that have been discussing about this. So what are we? What defines who we are? In principle, we may think we're our body, right? That's my hand, that's my arm, I mean, this is my leg. I mean, we're our body. Or maybe we're our memories. And philosopher has been discussing this since at least the time of this guy here, who was also in Oxford. So everything I will tell happened in Oxford. I don't know. I was preparing the lecture and said, man, did somebody do anything in this respect that wasn't in Oxford? So John Locke was perhaps the first one that studied seriously in philosophy personal identity. And he's very famous for proposing the paradox of the, or the parable of the prince and the cobbler. So basically one day the cobbler wakes up with the mind of the prince and the prince wakes up with the mind of the cobbler. So basically he swaps the two minds, right? And John Locke wondered, well, who is who? I mean, who is the cobbler and who is the prince? Will the cobbler be the cobbler body but with the prince head or with the prince mind? Or will the cobbler be the prince body with the cobbler's brain or mind? And at the end of the day, John Locke decided to go for, he called it like psychology, basically he meant memory. So he will say, well, whatever the memories are, this is what the person is. And as I say, not everybody agrees with that, but it's a very interesting discussion. And Borges somehow is touching on this, because Borges is saying, well, the guy that got Shakespeare memories starts being Shakespeare, and his own personal identity starts to be mingling with the wind of Shakespeare, so it's starting to be gone. So, and I like that, because that gives a very broad background, and I'm not talking science yet. I didn't say anything about science, but I study memory. And having these guys talking about memory this way, it's kind of like, it makes my studies way much more interesting than what they are just being in the lab measuring neurons. Basically, I mean, in part, I'm studying what makes us who we are, right? So let me tell you more about memory. Now let's dwell deeper about memory and try to understand a bit more. So I will tell you about another story of Borges, the second story that I want to tell you about, and the second main story. The other ones will be short fragments. That's called Funes de Memorios. He wrote this in 1941 in a book called Fictions, but actually this was first published in a newspaper called La Nación in Argentina. So I went to the National Library, so they have this newspaper since, I don't know, I mean, since the 18th century or so, I mean, since it was created, and I went to the exact date when I knew that he published this story. It was 7th of June, 1942, I think it was. And then, and then I found it was in the third page of an art and literature section, was the second section of the newspaper, or third section, so it was not front page. And the story is this one here. It is four columns and these two columns here with this illustration. And that's the first time Funes de Memorios was published. And if you study memory, you have heard about the story. It's a very, very well-known story. So he published it in this newspaper. So what is the story? Borges liked a lot to play with the idea of infinity, always. Not always, but very recurrently, right? And in this case, he played with the idea of how would it be to have infinite memory, to remember absolutely everything. So Funes de Memorios then is a story of a gaucho from Argentina, or Uruguay, in the border between Argentina and Uruguay, a city called Fray Ventos. And one day he falls from his horse, he hits his head so badly that when he recovers consciousness, something happens. And what happens is that from the moment he recovers consciousness, he will not forget anything ever again. He will start remembering absolutely everything, right? And then Borges starts wondering, how will it be for a person like this guy called Ireneo Funes to remember absolutely everything, right? So let's see what Borges says. I think it's better to read it from him than just me trying to quote or tell you what he said. So basically, how was the life for Funes? He said, we at a stroke perceive three cups lying on a table. Funes will see all the shoots and clusters and fruit comprised by a wine. He knew the shapes of the southern clouds on April 30, 1882, and could compare them in his memory with the streaks of a book of Spanish cover that he had seen only once, and with the swirls of the foam raised by an oar in the Rio Negro on the eve of the Battle of Quebracho. So he has an amazing capacity for remembering details. Details that in principle we say, come on, I mean, do we really want to remember that? But the guy could remember that. And sometimes we wonder, is that, well, would it be nice to remember more? I mean, because we remember so little from our youth, our childhood, our things that we want to remember. I mean, my work, I mean, I would like to remember all the papers I have read and so on, but I forget. And we all wonder, perhaps with some melancholy, is that, well, wouldn't it be nicer to remember more? But let's see what Borges says. Borges carries on and says, well, actually Funes says in the story, because Funes interacts with Borges in the short story, Funes says to Borges, "I alone have more memories than all men may have had since the world exists. And now comes the key. My memory, sir, is like a rubbish heap, un vaciadero de basuras." And then Borges makes this click, and this click is like, wow, that's, I didn't expect that. Why? So basically he's telling us here, well, maybe having such a memory is not that good. Actually, the guy didn't like having that memory, Funes, right? So how did Borges come with this crazy idea of remembering everything? And most importantly, how he came up with the idea that maybe remember everything may not be that good, or may not be as good as we think it might be, right? So I was very puzzled, and I studied memory, and I really wanted to know where this comes from. And I met his widow. I had many interactions with his widow, Maria Kodama. But the first hints of how he came up with the idea are already in the story. So in the story, Borges interacts with Funes, right? He writes in first person, and he says that one time Funes asked him, of course it's fiction, right? This didn't exist. But one time Funes asked him to bring him some Latin book and a dictionary so that he can learn Latin, right? And Borges said, yeah, sure. I mean, I get you a Latin book, dictionary, you can learn it. But the guy did, and next time they met, he's quoting things in Latin. And the book that Borges gave him was this one. That's perhaps the first encyclopedia in history. It's called the Naturalis Historia from Pliny the Elder. And you can get this encyclopedia, I mean, you can get this everywhere. I mean, there are several volumes. And in one of the volumes, Pliny talks about, I mean, Pliny more or less is was a Roman more or less at the time of Jesus Christ. And he describes all what is known about the world in this encyclopedia, which has many books, and each book with several chapters. And Pliny has a book, especially a set of chapters about people with some extraordinary talents. And one of the chapters is about people with extraordinary memory. And there he describes, like for example, King Cyrus of Persia, who knew the name of all his soldiers. And the Persian Empire, I mean, had many, many soldiers, right? Or he talks about a guy called Mithridates Eupatus, who could administer justice in the 22 languages of his empire. Or Simonides, who was the inventor of mnemotechnics. Or Charmidas, the Greek, who could read a book, or who could recite a book as if he was reading it out of memory. So Pliny already talks about many cases of people with extraordinary memory. But if you see other chapters, for example, I tell you two that I remember. There's a chapter about people with extraordinary sight. He describes people with extraordinary sight. And he describes one person that could see so well that he wrote the Iliad from Homer, right, in such a tiny script, with such a tiny letter, that he can, I mean, get the paper into a nutshell. Or he talks about another guy called Strabo, who during the time of the Punic Wars, he could sit in a mount in Sicily and see the ships taking off from Carthage, I mean, across the Mediterranean. And of course, this is impossible. This is an exaggeration. So that's actually one influence of Borges, I mean, the idea of these characters. And actually, Borges describes some of these characters in Funes and Memorios, but we know these things are not true. I mean, we know that there's not a guy that can remember the name of all the soldiers of the Persian Empire. Right, I mean, and Pliny was a little bit exaggerating. So the question is, did people like this really exist? Because it's already fascinating, no? I mean, because for me as a neuroscientist, the vision of Borges saying, well, you think you want to have memory, lots of memory, but maybe it's not that good, right? And that's very brilliant. And did somebody in science thought about this? Did somebody in science actually study people like this? Are there really cases like this? That is Funes and Memorios. Surprisingly, yes, right? I don't know if you have seen this person before. If I will be giving this talk, actually I gave this similar talk in Moscow, in Russia, some time ago, everybody will know who this person is. He was kind of like one of the big figures that founded Russian, modern psychology. That's Alexander Romanovich Luria, one of the most brightest psychologists in Russia in the 20th century. And Luria studied medicine. He also studied psychology. Well, he became a psychiatrist. And in his early 20s, he started seeing patients. He was a very young psychiatrist. And one day came this crazy gentleman to him. If you study memory, this is a very rare picture. You will never see a picture of this person. He's a very well-known person for people who study memory. His name is Solomon Shereshevsky, right? Patient S, as Luria called him. So what happened? So this guy came one day to Luria, and Luria asked him, so what's the matter? And this guy said, I can't forget. Luria said, well, sure. That was in the 1920s, right? No Borges, nothing. Borges didn't even think about writing this book. And Luria says, okay. And then he gave him a list of 30 numbers to remember. Shereshevsky will see the list and can tell them without any mistake. Then he gave him 50 numbers. He added 20 more. Shereshevsky will still remember. He added 20 more, 70 numbers. Shereshevsky will tell you the list. That's actually the list of 70 numbers that Shereshevsky remembered. That's from Luria's reports, right? So, and Luria will say, well, can you read it? Or can you tell me the list backwards? Can you tell me the second column? Can you tell me the fifth row? Can you tell me one after the sequence 3, 1, 3, 2? The way Luria describes it is as Shereshevsky had kind of like a picture of the table in his mind. Of course, he was not seeing the table anymore, right? Now, that was very interesting for Luria. And Luria actually studied Shereshevsky for 30 years, right? Quite a long time. And 15 years after the first time they met, Luria one day tells Shereshevsky, do you remember the first time we ever met? Shereshevsky said, yes, you were wearing this white coat and you were wearing a tie like this and so on. Luria couldn't remember. But Luria did have this little paper. And then Luria asked him 15 years later, without Shereshevsky knowing that he kept the paper that he will ever ask again, do you remember the table that I gave you to read or to remember 15 years ago? And Shereshevsky could repeat the table from beginning to end without a single problem, right? And Luria, in an amazing book called The Mind of a Memonist, talks about many things that Shereshevsky could remember that were for him inconceivable. So, do you know what is this? Nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita, mi ritrovai per una selva oscura, blah, 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 blah. You know what is this?
Dante.
That's Dante, right? These are the first stanzas from La Divina Commedia, Divine Comedy. These and four more stanzas were given to Shereshevsky. Luria gave Shereshevsky these and four more stanzas to remember. Don't forget, Shereshevsky was Russian, didn't speak Italian, right? So for the guy, these words didn't have any meaning. They were completely senseless syllables and so on. But Luria read it and he remembered it. And again, 15 years later, Luria asked him, do you remember the thing that I gave you from Dante to remember? And the guy can recite the first, these and four more stanzas from the Divine Comedy out of memory without even understanding what he's talking about. And Luria at some point said in his book, in his report, I gave up. And the way he described it is very beautiful, because he said, I failed in the easiest task you can ask a psychologist, to test the limits of somebody's memory. If you are a psychologist, that's the easiest you can do. You start giving numbers or words and so on, and at some point you will see that the person you are studying starts failing. Well, you cannot remember more than a certain number of things, right? There's a magic number 7 that people quote, for example. But with Shereshevsky, Luria says, well, I give up. This guy has unlimited memory capacities. But now here comes the click. And Luria was very special because he was an amazing scientist, but at the same time, I wouldn't say he was an artist, but he was a humanist, right? He didn't care just about science and experiments. And the very big click, and something that was quite unique about Luria, is that at some point he says, well, actually, I don't care. Maybe I find the limit of the memory of this guy, but that's not the question. The question is, how is it to live with such a memory? And then Luria completely turns and says, well, I will stop testing this guy. I want to understand how it is to live with a memory like that. And that comes the brilliancy from Luria. And look at what he did. One day he gave him this table to remember. Actually, it wasn't him, it was another scientist that worked close to Luria, another of the grandfathers of Russian psychology called Vygotsky. They gave him this table. It's trivial. 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 5, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. And Sherezhevsky, of course, could remember it. But he didn't notice that there were consecutive numbers. He was learning it by heart. Actually, Luria gave him this table. I'm mixing it up. Vygotsky did something, the colleague of Luria, did something else which is also very clever. Vygotsky gave him a list of words, many, many words, right? I don't remember how many, maybe 50 words. And Sherezhevsky remembered each of the words, and then Vygotsky asked him, okay, tell me the words. And Sherezhevsky will tell one after the other. And then Vygotsky asked him, okay, tell me only the liquids in this list. Imagine that I give you a list, it's like chair, water, coffee, screen, computer, and so on. I say, well, tell me the liquids. Well, I say water and coffee, right? Sherezhevsky couldn't. He could tell the list by heart, but he couldn't tell which of the items were liquids. And then Luria concluded that Sherezhevsky, and I'm quoting Luria, was quite inept at any logical organization. So he could remember by heart, but he couldn't think. He couldn't really come to a high level process of cognition to understand what he was remembering. Now, there's a very interesting parallel now, talking about art and science, or science and humanities, and there's a very big interesting parallel between the character that Borges described, Irenaeo Funes, in Funes de Memorios, and the character that Luria studied, Solomon Sherezhevsky, and he wrote about this character in The Mind of a Memonist. And there are many people that have been wondering, did Borges knew about Luria? Because Luria studied Sherezhevsky in the 1920s, and Borges wrote his story in 1941. I dig a lot about this. I talked to many people that knew Borges and that worked with Borges or interacted with Borges, also his widow, and I can tell you I'm pretty sure Borges didn't know about Luria. The main reason why is because Luria published this book only in 1968, and then it came in English, right? But nobody in the scientific world knew about Luria and Sherezhevsky in the 1940s. And much less Borges, because Borges was not a scientist, he was a writer, right? If scientists didn't know about Luria, imagine Borges, he was a writer. He knew about philosophy and writers, but not about psychology in Russia. And actually he was not that interested in, he was interested in psychology. So where did Borges get this idea from? Well, this idea is actually not that new, because Borges didn't know about Luria, but he knew about this gentleman here, William James. And I told you about Luria, about the grandfather of Russian modern psychology. That was the grandfather of, the psychology happening in the Western world, William James, late 19th century. So William James wrote an amazing book, two volumes called The Principles of Psychology, that was published in 1890. And Borges did know about William James a lot. There are two or three reasons why Borges knew about William James. One reason is because William James was the brother of Henry James, and Henry James was a very famous writer. And of course, Borges knew about Henry James, and through him about William James. And Borges was very interested also in philosophy. And William James wrote a lot about philosophy, pragmatism. And the other reason is that, I have even a stronger reason, I'll tell you this at the very end. The other reason is that Borges' father was a lawyer, but he was teaching psychology, and he used to take Borges to the National Library, and the father of Borges will be preparing his lectures and getting all the psychology books, and Borges was glancing all these books and about James and so on. And the final reason is that since I knew his widow, she let me see Borges' books, his personal library, and he had many books of James. So clearly he knew about William James. So, and let's see what William James said at 1890, right? And that doesn't come only from James, comes also from a person called Lansdowne Down, who you may know, because of the Down syndrome, but he's the first one describing these savants, they're called. So look at William James said. William James said, if we remember everything, we should be on most occasion be as ill off as if we remember nothing. The paradoxical result is that one condition for remembering is that we should forget. To remember, we should forget. Without totally forgetting a prodigious number of states of consciousness and momentary forgetting a large number, we could not remember at all. Without forgetting, we could not remember. Sounds paradoxical, but William James was saying this. So, Borges, Luria, James, Lanson Down, they all recognize the importance of forgetting. We don't want to remember too much, but we don't also want to forget too much. So there's a balance between remembering and forgetting. And that's somehow what I illustrate here. I don't know if you have seen that. That's a painting from Rossetti of Mnemosyne, was a goddess from the ancient Greek, and she was the goddess of memory. And in the Greek mythology, she is the mother of the musas, the muses, which are all the different sorts of inspiration, artistic inspiration. Because for the Greek, all the different forms of arts, they come from memory. So these are three of the nine daughters of the muses, and one is dealing with history, another with theater and poetry, and so on. So for the ancient Greeks, memory is the mother of all these things. And for the ancient Greeks, memory was key, because they didn't have laptops, they didn't even have paper, right? So if you imagine, if I'm standing here giving a speech, I won't have a PowerPoint. I just talk out of what I remember. So if I don't remember, maybe I say a couple of sentences and then I'm blank, right? So I have to rely on my memory. And the ancient Greeks describe a lot. I mean, there are a couple of treatises about rhetoric, how to speak in public, and a big component of rhetoric is memory. So memory was considered like a big talent. And that's why Pliny, when writing the encyclopedia, is describing these extraordinary memory cases as he's describing people with amazing strength because they can fight in battle and so on. Memory was a big thing. But we don't want to remember too much. We don't want to forget too much either. So this is Mnemosyne. These are three of the muses, daughter of Mnemosyne. And this is a river in Alaska called Leth. And the name was given, inspired in also a mythological tradition in Greece, a mythological idea in Greece that Leth is the river of oblivion. So basically for the Greeks, when a person dies, he will be taken to the waters of Leth, where all the memories will be wiped out, and then the person gets reborn, but with blank memories, right? So we don't want to be like Mnemosyne, but we also don't want to wash ourselves in the waters of Leth, no? So we want to have a compromise. So let me tell you what happens in the case when you forget too much. And most what we know about memory, a huge amount of what we know about memory comes from the study of this guy here. And for all of us doing neuroscience, this guy was historically known as Patient HM. And we keep on hearing about Patient HM, and Patient HM revolutionized science, particularly science related to memory. But we never knew his name, we never knew his face. He died in 2008, and since then we know that his name was Henry Molaison. And that's how he looked like before he had a surgery that I will tell you about in a second, and that's how he looked like in his late 60s or so, right? So HM, Henry Molaison, suffered from epilepsy that couldn't be controlled with medication. And in 1953, this surgeon, William Scoville, proposed him to do an experimental surgical approach that hadn't been tested before. But that was because there was no other way to treat Henry Molaison. He couldn't work, he couldn't do anything. And then William Scoville said, well, look, I mean, we know that epilepsy in your case is very likely to be started in an area called the hippocampus, which is here. It's inside the brain, right? Inside the cortex. And what he said is, I propose to remove the hippocampi. We have a left and a right one. And hopefully I will cure you from epilepsy. And as far as we know, this area has no function. I mean, nothing should happen, right? But he didn't know. He was very clear. He agreed, the family agreed. It was very risky. It was experimental. They didn't really know what would happen. So he underwent this surgery when he was 27, and he recovered. And the first test are completely normal. He can speak, he can remember people and so on. He looked like a clever person as he was before. The problem is he couldn't form new memories ever again. So a new doctor will come through this door, look at him, say, hi, how are you doing today, and this and that, then get out, come again, and Molaison will not know who this guy is, although he just had been in the room. So there were two, well, mainly one person that studied this guy. His name was, her name is Brenda Miller, and in Canada. And when Molaison died, she studied Molaison for 30 years, paradoxically the same amount of time that Luria studied Choroshevsky. And when Molaison died, Brenda Miller, who studied him for 30 years, said, it's a very strange feeling because I feel like a big friend has died, but a friend that never knew my name. And Brenda Miller made her whole career studying this guy. And that's not despective, no? Because I said, most of what we know about memory, or a big amount of what we know about memory, is thanks to the study of this guy, and actually through Brenda Miller. So then we know in our days that if you take out this area, the hippocampus, that's it. You cannot possibly form new memories. You are becoming amnesic. You will still remember things from the past, but whatever happens from the surgery onwards, you will not remember. Right? Felipe? And this is very nicely, if you like movies, this is very nicely characterized in the movie Memento. A guy that cannot form memories and he's taking Polaroids the whole time and taking notes in a Polaroid. Right? It's a very nice characterization of HM. Now, funnily enough, this surgery that William Scoville did is actually done nowadays and with great success. Epileptic patients that cannot be treated with medication, in many cases, they go to a surgical approach, get the hippocampus removed, and they get cured, and they don't lose memory. You know what's the difference? The difference is that you will take only one hippocampus out, never both. So basically, if you take the pathological hippocampus out, and the healthy in principle, no, or the more healthy is there, this one will somehow take the memory functions and the patient will carry on. And he may have some memories, a little bit deficits, but he won't become amnesic. And he is very likely to be cured. Actually, the chances are 85% or so. It's very, very high. It's one of the most successful procedures in neurology. In neurology, it's very hard to cure a patient. In this case, it is quite possible to cure a patient. But you never take both. If you take both out, that's it. You have HM, the patient becomes amnesic. Now, if you're going to take off one hippocampus, you want to make very, very sure you're taking the right one, right? Because if you take the healthy one out, that's it. You leave a pathological hippocampus there. The patient will have memory problems and will continue to be epileptic. So in many cases, what they do to try to be as certain as possible that they're targeting the right hippocampus or the right area is to introduce electrodes, and this is what you see here. This surgeon is introducing a tiny needle, I will say, that is flexible inside the brain. And the idea is that from this electrode, they will record the brain activity to identify where the seizures come from, and then to be sure which area is the one starting the epileptic seizures. And this is the area they will potentially surgically remove, right, to cure the patient. And as I say, this is very successful. Now, to us scientists, I'm not a clinician, I studied physics and math. To us scientists, this is an amazing opportunity because these guys, they must have these electrodes implanted in the brain. 5 minutes, okay. So there's no way around it. They have to have these electrodes implanted. So basically, they stay 1 week in hospital and we can record their activity, we can record from many neurons during a week, right? Because they have to have these electrodes implanted. So our experiments basically are how do neurons in the brain in this area that is known to be important in memory will respond to different things. And I will show you some of these. One more. Okay, I will show you three slides with results, which is very easy to understand. So this is something that, I found like 10, 12 years ago. In one of these patients that had this electrode implanted, I found a neuron that responded to Jennifer Aniston, the actress. And the patient knew Jennifer Aniston very well. That's why I tried these things, things that are very familiar to the patient. And no matter how I showed her, I mean, the neuron responded to Jennifer Aniston, right? And didn't respond to other people. Remember that? Remember? Another neuron responded to another actress, Halle Berry. And even if she was masked as Catwoman, but the patient knew that it was Halle Berry, even to the name Halle Berry, but not to other names. One more. Another neuron responded to myself. We're all very important, right? I put. No, but that's because the patient get to know us very well. I'm every day with the patient, so I become very familiar. Even to my name written on the screen, and even to my name saved by the computer, which is this thing here. Now, the interesting point of all this is that the neuron fires two concepts. And that was the big thing, the big novelty in neuroscience. That would surprise my colleagues, right? That would make really a nightmare to publish this paper because nobody could believe it. And he said, well, it's there. It's there. I mean, no matter which picture I show, the neuron fires. If I show other pictures, the neuron doesn't fire. Even if I write the name, the neuron fires. The neuron is firing to the person, not to a particular picture. And nobody expected that. Nobody ever found something like this in monkeys or in any animals, right? So, one more. Then, why do we have these neurons? I mean, I'm speeding up because I don't have time. Why do we have these neurons firing to concepts in a memory area? We know this area is linked to memory. If you take it out, you become amnesic. Well, actually, we don't tend to remember many details, right? We don't remember like fullness, that he remembered every tree and everything. No, we remember, yeah, there was a tree and so on. How the tree looked like, I don't remember. Basically, you step out from here, and 2 weeks from now, I don't say like 10 years, 1 week from now, a few days from now, you try to remember my talk, and you will remember just a few concepts, right? Oh, Jennifer Aniston, Borges, Shakespeare, and a few things. And the more time you let pass, the fewer concepts you may remember. We tend to forget details. So basically what I argue and what we are doing in my lab, that's the science part, I mean, is showing how these neurons are the building blocks of memories. Why do we have neurons firing to concepts? Well, because memories is nothing more, nothing less than conceptualizing things and making associations between concepts, right? So first you want a conceptual representation because you want to forget details, otherwise you end up with like fullness. You don't want to be like fullness. You want to remember the important things, the concepts. And this is exactly what these neurons represent, the things that you tend to remember and that you want to remember, right? And then you make links between these concepts. And I finish with this, one more. So back to Borges. I mean, I had two more stories to tell about Borges, but it's running too long. But I tell you, I will finish with this. I will finish with a quote, again, from Funes de Memorios. So I'm telling you that in my work in neuroscience, I found these neurons that they do not fire to details, right? They are in a memory area, and they fire to a concept. And I'm telling you that it makes sense that they don't fire to details. So let's see what Borges said 70 years before I found these neurons in 1941. So he said, It was not only difficult for him, for Funes, to understand that the generic term dog embraced so many unlike specimens of different sizes and different forms. He was disturbed by the fact that a dog at 314, seen in profile, should have the same name as a dog at 315, seen from the front. Complete lack of conceptualization. Two views of the dogs, they're two different things for him, right? And now comes the most interesting, and with this I finish. To think is to forget differences, to generalize, to abstract. In Funes' crowded world, there was nothing but almost immediate details. That's it. Thank you.